Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Wednesday Checkup. I am vaccinated. If I were to have children, they'd be vaccinated. And I am a doctor who's pro-vaccine. I wanted to get this video out as soon as possible. When I heard that there was a video made between anti-vax and pro-vaccine folks, I decided to watch it and give you my reaction live right here, first time watching it. Becoming an anti-vaccine activist based on your own experience of having a negative outcome to a vaccine, to me, is not wise.
Before all this happened, she was a competitive gymnast, and she used to walk up and down the stairs like she was 90 years old. She couldn't hold a pencil in her hand. Now she's back on the bars, back on the beam, doing things which my wife and I never thought that she would do again.
I'm so proud of these doctors that they're coming in and really avoiding digging into data and numbers and confusing and confounding the conversation further. They're telling personal stories. They're telling personal stories. They're making it emotional. Becoming an anti-vaccine activist based on your own experience of having a negative outcome to a vaccine, to me, is not wise. I'm so proud of these doctors that they're coming in. They're telling personal stories. They're making it emotional.
I see the worst of the worst. And so seeing the other side of kids who don't get vaccinated, I saw a kid walk in with meningococcemia, which I haven't seen in decades. He had all four limbs cut off. They had to be amputated because it was all dead tissue. You forget how bad things were before we had vaccines.
I'm really proud that the intensivists took this route, because many times subspecialists will often run to talking about statistics or studies and research. And to people who are not of scientific education, it's difficult to relate to that. But when you tell a powerful story like he just did, that really strikes the message home, that children are dying, they're losing limbs unnecessarily.
You forget how bad things were before we had vaccines. You forget how bad things were before we had vaccines. I saw a kid walk in with meningococcemia, which I haven't seen in decades. I saw a kid walk in with meningococcemia, which I haven't seen in decades. He had all four limbs cut off.
That really strikes the message home, that children are dying, they're losing limbs unnecessarily. Becoming an anti-vaccine activist based on your own experience of having a negative outcome to a vaccine, to me, is not wise.
The side effects are like one in a million, one in 2 million. Whereas the side effects from the diseases, when I see all these outbreaks and things like that, I'm gonna choose vaccines every time.
What's interesting here is, yes, it may not be one in a million or one in 2 million, whatever the odds are.
I think the number you're referring to is anaphylactic shock. That anaphylactic shock is, of course, extremely rare. Whereas when you look at seizures from the MMR vaccine are one in 3,000. Seizures from the MMR vaccine are 1 in 3,000.
But again, this creates fear.
Well, we worry that those on your side kind of downplay those.
We don't necessarily downplay them. We weigh them against the benefits of getting the vaccine. We as doctors make the recommendation that taking the 1 in 3,000 risk of having a seizure is worth it to prevent this deadly illness from happening.
I want to show you what we discovered when the FDA sent us the trials of the MMR vaccine. Let's take a look at this on the board back here. So first of all, you'll always hear from the pharmaceutical industry and the medical establishment that, you know, well, that study that showed that the vaccine causes autism, or that study that showed that vaccines lead to autoimmune diseases, it was too small a study. I mean, it just wasn't a well-powered study. For instance, the Mawson study out of Mississippi in 2017 that compared vaccinated to unvaccinated children in the homeschool community. That had 640 kids in that study. And what they found was those who were vaccinated had 4 times the rate of autism, 5 times the rate of neurological disorder, 30 times the rate of allergic rhinitis, and I think 3 times the rate of anaphylactic food allergies. The list went on and on. But they say, well, there weren't enough kids in that study. Well, we all know that that's a pilot study. So now that we have seen a signal from this small study, why don't you do a bigger study? But you want to talk about the hypocrisy. This measles vaccine, the new measles vaccine, only had just over 800 total kids in 8 different studies. All 8 studies put together, there was only just over 800 kids that were going to decide the fate of all of our children worldwide and the safety of the MMR vaccine. Now, we believe that there's really only 3 of these studies you can count on because they're the only ones that compared MMR to a different vaccine. For instance, rubella by itself or measles by itself. If you're going to compare one MMR to another MMR, then all you're comparing are the differences in those 2 vaccines, not the vaccine itself. So let's look at these first 3 studies that are going to compare the MMR, in this case, to the measles rubella vaccine or just the rubella vaccine. Get ready for this, folks. This is breaking. And for those out there that say Dell is sharing misinformation, this misinformation comes straight from the Food and Drug Administration. These are the actual trials that approved the MMR vaccine. Here's the first thing I want you to look at based on the stage that I've laid. Gastrointestinal illness is the complaint of the autism community. Somehow these two are connected. Well, guess what? They looked at that in the MMR 2 trials in 1978. This is the first of the studies. 199 children in this study. Is that a joke? Is that some kind of joke? 199 children in a study for a vaccine that's going to be given to millions, hundreds of millions of children around the world? No, it's not. 199 children. Now look at this. Of those 199 children, gastrointestinal illness. They looked at it. They had a category. And here's what they found. Gastrointestinal illness over the course of 42 days, by the way. I've told you that drugs are going through safety studies for 5 years, 10 years. I've told you there's not a saline group in here. They never compare this vaccine to a saline group to really have a true control group, which is that's a gold standard of safety testing. We've already said they've never done that. This is proof again, but they don't go 5 years on the study. They don't go 5 months. They don't go 5 weeks? 6 weeks, 42 days. That's the maximum amount any of these studies go through. And here's what we found when we compared the MMR. Gastrointestinal illness. 22 children in this study had a gastrointestinal illness out of 199. That's 10%. Not 1 in a million, 10% got a gastrointestinal illness. Look at this list. Upper respiratory illness. How many times are we being told, well, even if the vaccine doesn't work, it helps with upper respiratory health? Really? Because this vaccine looks like it caused 23 cases of upper respiratory illness out of 199 children, 10%. 10% get a gastrointestinal illness. Good for you. You're so lucky. You're welcome. And another 10% get an upper respiratory illness. Okay? Let's look at the next study. Here's number two in the three they chose. Now this time they have a whopping 102 total children in this very important study. Now look at this. Upper respiratory illness, 64. 64 out of 102 children, more than half, moving towards two-thirds. Gastrointestinal illness, the heart and problem of autism. Look at in this group, 43. 43 children had a gastrointestinal illness within 42 days out of 102 children. I can't make this up. Does someone want to tell me what I'm missing here? And if you think somehow I'm overstating it, they'll say, Dell's a journalist. He doesn't understand how to read a graph. He doesn't understand how to read these things. So let's just read it in their own words, shall we? This is what they wrote in their report. Upper respiratory and gastrointestinal infections were reported in about 55% and 40% of vaccinees, respectively. This is the misinformation they don't want you to hear. We approved a horrific vaccine that's being given to our children.
I think it's interesting that Washington is declaring a state of emergency over 35 cases of measles, when in the entire United States, no children have died of measles, you know, in the last, you know, 15 years. You know, the last childhood fatality we had was in 2003. So, but you know what fatalities we have had is we've had fatalities from the actual measles vaccine. And in the last, you know, 15 years, there have been over 100 of these fatal reactions to the MMR vaccine with zero fatalities in children from the measles disease.
As of right now, the benefits outweigh the harms when it comes to vaccines, and you should vaccinate your children.
Is it possible that there's one more reason you wouldn't vaccinate? Is it possible, just possible, that you want the measles? Even more than just wanting a lifelong immunity, is there benefit to having infections as a child? Well, I believe there are. And I know that there's science, really good science, that shows that. So let's look at a little bit of that as we look at the entire, you know, depth and fact-based issue around the measles. This is what we know, that if you have had the measles, and there's multiple studies, one study showed that people who did not have wild measles had a 67% increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. This is it, Leukemia Research in Elsevier. This is a serious medical journal. Do childhood diseases affect NHL and HL? So non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and Hodgkin's lymphoma, a case control study from Northern Ireland. What it discovered was that those who did not have wild measles had a 67% increased risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and a 233% increased risk of Hodgkin lymphoma. Our study shows that measles may provide a protective effect against non-Hodgkin lymphoma. So let's think about this. We know that so far, I think that 174 people have died from the vaccine itself. We know that every year, about 400 people would die in America from the measles in the 1960s before the vaccine ever arrived. Now that sounds like a huge number, but remember, 5 million people got the measles that year. So that means 1 in 10,000 would die. Obviously, those that were already malnourished and had other massive health complications. Who knows if it was not measles, it might have been something else. But 400 cases. So the question is, we always ask ourselves, does the benefit outweigh the risk? Does the benefit of the vaccine outweigh its risks? So sure, we can only really prove that there's something like 170 deaths from the MMR vaccine. So you could say, well, we're not getting 400 deaths from measles every year, so maybe it's working. Except that we have a problem. The problem is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is claiming the lives of thousands of people every year. Hodgkin's lymphoma, not quite as dramatic a death rate, but still kills a lot. So if we were able to cut that, if you have a 67% increased risk, essentially you could say that those people with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, half of them wouldn't have it had they had the measles. That right there covers the 400 you just saved. And then Hodgkin's lymphoma, but it gets better. There are studies that have looked at heart disease, which kills 610,000 Americans. Association of measles and mumps with cardiovascular disease, the Japan collaborative cohort study. This study found that if you had had measles and mumps as a child, that your risk for heart disease was decreased in varying places, but at the very least by 10%. Conclusion, measles and mumps, especially in case of both infections, were associated with lower risks of mortality from atherosclerotic CVD. Cardiovascular disease, okay, that's what that is. So if 610,000 people die every year from cardiovascular disease, and you could just reduce that by 10%, taking the most conservative numbers from having had measles and mumps as a child, that's 61,000 people saved right there. So now we're in the tens of thousands, 60s, nearing hundreds of thousands of people. Another study looked at ovarian cancer and found that if you had, here we go, acute infections as a means of cancer prevention, opposing effects to chronic infections. And in this study, once again, we found if you had exposures to febrile infections, childhood diseases were associated with subsequently reduced risks of melanoma, ovary, and multiple cancers combined. In fact, ovarian cancer looked like it was reduced by nearly 50%, cut in half. Hundreds of thousands of people saved by simply allowing them to get wild measles and wild mumps, compared to the 400 we brag about that no longer die from measles.
If you choose not to vaccinate your children and you're okay with your child getting measles or one of these illnesses, what about the children that have an immunodeficiency or have some sort of other issue that they can't get vaccines? And as a result of that, your child then spreads a deadly illness to them and they die too. You fall into the population that needs to be protected by herd immunity.
You're talking herd immunity. And those were the studies back where they were actually looking at the wild viruses that would affect and that would decrease its spread. It has nothing to do with vaccines.
What is herd immunity? First of all, herd immunity was a natural immunity term. They said if 60% of the people got measles, that town would be protected for decades because those people would be immune to measles for life. Can vaccines achieve herd immunity the same way natural immunity? Everybody over the age of 25 years old, if you have not had a booster shot in the last 10 years, your vaccines have worn off. They want to say that herd immunity really exists because 95% of the kids in school are all immune because of their vaccines. But when we pull back, what do we see? We see the entire adult population of this nation is currently unvaccinated.
After 5 years, your antibody levels pretty much fall below, so you need to get more vaccines between 5 and 10 years. So if anybody in the population hasn't had their vaccines within 5 to 10 years, you're considered the unvaccinated, so you should be infecting all the vaccinated people. See that circular logic? Well, circular psychosis.
I want to go to that right now because I think you're going to find this absolutely fascinating. So HHS genotyped the measles, the cases that were in the Disneyland outbreak, which was it was the number one biggest outbreak America had had. Now they're calling it perhaps this one's passing it. This is the second biggest outbreak. So look at this. When they genotyped the measles, 31 genotype A vaccine strain from recently vaccinated persons with febrile rash illness. 73 specimens were genotype B3 outbreak strain. So that right there, roughly 38% of the cases in Disneyland were vaccine strain measles. I want you to wrap your head around this. If you're new to this, and this is what this show does. We get into science. If you're bored, go ahead. Go back to the talking heads. They have a bumper sticker you can repeat over and over again. But I'm bringing you the science. And you can look all this up again. Type ICAN, I-C-A-N, right now in your comments. But think about this. This slideshow we now have from Health and Human Services was put together before SB 277 was passed. Before SB 277 was passed, Health and Human Services was presenting a slideshow saying, we have a problem, folks. 38% of the cases in this measles outbreak that we're making everybody terrified about, that we're going to pass a law to make you give up your rights to force vaccinate every child, whether the parent wants to or not. We're going to run that law and say that the reason we have to force vaccinate you and take your rights away as a citizen, remove body autonomy and the ability to control what's injected in your child is because of the immunosuppressed child. We need to protect, we need to build a herd around that immunosuppressed child, and the only way to do that is everybody has to be vaccinated. But here's the problem. Nearly half, maybe I'm stretching it, but more than a third of the cases in the biggest outbreak that we've genotyped so far were caused by the vaccine. And Pan knew this. We know that Senator Richard Pan knew this when he lied to you and said you could protect an immunosuppressed child. The truth is that vaccinated are putting your child at 38% of the risk of coming in contact with the measles. Because if you are getting the measles from the vaccine, here it is, during the measles outbreak in California in 2015, a large number of suspected cases occurred in recent vaccinees. Of the 194 measles virus sequences obtained in the United States in 2015, 73 were identified as vaccine sequences. Look at that, and look who wrote that. I didn't write that. That's not from Del Bigtree. It's not from Bobby Kennedy. It's not from Andy Wakefield. This is the Journal of Clinical Microbiology, the American Society for Microbiology. I think they know what they're talking about. I would guess we should be able to trust them. I don't think they have an agenda to lie to us. So do you see the problem here? If you can get measles from the vaccine, and if you can shed measles, which some of those cases, the 73, may very well have gotten it from being near people who had just gotten the vaccine. If you see the page in the oncology center saying, if you've been recently vaccinated, do not enter here. This is all proof, folks, that vaccines shed.
If a parent brings in a child and says they're acting differently, that's a huge warning sign. And any doctor that brushes that off and says, I disagree, that's a bad sign from a doctor. I would actually recommend switching doctors or in the room, if you're comfortable, pointing that out to the doctor that you don't think that's the right method and you're not comfortable. If they don't welcome your criticism or your thoughts on the matter, switch doctors. It's really that simple. I don't think we should become hostile to anti-vaxxers. I think the role here is to be compassionate.